Hi Sakshi.
Hi Dev.
Hi Harika. So those who are online, please say hi in the chat window so that we can start the session quickly. I think there are 6 people are watching. Please say hi in the chat window so that we can start the session. Hi Ashi. So let us start. So in the previous session, we discussed about sets, the basics of sets, that is, what is a Cartesian product on set, what are relations. I've taken a basic example of relations and we have taken some practice questions. Now in this video, in this class, we will be discussing about the operations that you can perform on set. So in the previous session, previous class, hum log ne discuss kiya tha ki set ke basics kya hote hain. That is, what are the basics of sets and how can you perform Cartesian product in a set? What is a set with only one element, that is single sentence set? What is the subset operation? What is a proper subset operation? So we have seen all these basics in the previous class. Now in this class, initially we will look at some of the basic operations that you can perform on set, that is union, intersection. And then we will look at the most important topic for the examination, which is relations. So relations also we are going to cover in today's class itself. Okay, so basics of set is a small topic, and the relations, again, that is going to be very important topic for the session. Okay, so let us start. Sure Dev, can you just send the question that you want me to discuss? Just send that on Telegram group so that we can discuss that, okay? So we'll discuss, we'll take the doubts also. But let us start with the union first of all. So we have union. So what is union? Just read on the screen. Let A and B be the sets. The union of the set A and B, denoted by A union B, is the set that contains those elements that are either in A or in B or in both. So union is again one of the very easy operation. So what exactly is a union? Is, let us assume that this is the first set, the set A, which is having the elements 1, 3 and 5. And this is the set B, which is having the elements 1, 2 and 3. Now if I take A union B, so that means A union B is going to contain the elements which are present in A or in B or in both. So any element which is repeated twice, I mean any element which is present in A as well as it is also present in B, that element will be counted only once. For example, here 1 is present in A as well as 1 is also present in B. So this element will be added only once, it will not be added twice. So here you can see the union will contain 1. Now second element here is 2. 2 is present in B but not in A, so 2 will be in the union. Next element is 3. 3 is present in A as well as in B. So in case of union, 3 will be counted only once. That means 3 will come here. And then next element is 5. 5 is present in A but not in B. So 5 will also come here. So you can see, when you do union operation, so in that case, any repeated element which is present in both the sets, that is added only once, or any element which is present in only one set, that will be added. Okay, that is going to be your union operation, which is a very easy operation, very basic operation, that is a union operation. So the next operation here is intersection. Now intersection means we are going to take the elements which is present in both the sets. Okay, so for example, let us assume we have a set A. We have a set A which is having the values which are 1, 3 and 5. We have a set B. It is having the values 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, these are the values. If I take A intersection with B, that means we are going to have the elements which are present in both the sets. For example, 1 is present in both of these sets. So A intersection B is going to contain 1. Next, 2 is not present in both the sets, but 3 is present in both the sets. So 3 will be coming here. Now 4 is not present in both the sets, and as well as 5 is also not present in both the sets. So in this case, if you take A intersection B, that is going to have the elements which is 1 and 3. It is very basic operation which is intersection. Now that means if you represent union, so union is going to contain elements which is present in A, as well as it is also those elements which are also present in B, and those elements which are present in both of them, they will be considered only once. Okay. Now if you have intersection means we are going to take those elements which is present in both A as well as B. So intersection is the elements which is present in both the sets. Union is all the elements which are present in both the sets. Okay. I hope this is clear. I hope there is no issues with union and intersection. So union and intersections both are very basic operations. So here you can see how you can represent union. The basic definition of union is, here you can see the basic definition of intersection. So if you take A intersection B, so that is equal to element X such that X belongs to A, as well as the element X should also belong to B. And here the operator that we are applying is AND. So intersection means the element should be present in set A and it should also be present in set B. That is called as your intersection operation. So this is just a simple example of intersection. For example, here the first set is having the elements 1, 3 and 5. The second set is having the element 1 and 2 and 3. Now here if you take the intersection of the first set and intersection of the second set, so the elements which is present in the first as well as second set is 1 and 3. So that will be the intersection which is 1, 3. And if you take the union of these two sets, if you take the union of this set as well as union of this set, so the union is going to have 1, 2, 3 and 5. So very easy operation which is union as well as intersection. Now the next operation is, next is disjoint set. So sometimes what happens is when two sets are not having anything in common, they are not having any element in common, in that case if you take intersection, so intersection will be phi. Phi means an empty set. So that means if both the sets are not having anything in common, so we call those sets as disjoint sets. Again I am saying, if the intersection of two sets is phi, then we call those sets as disjoint sets because they are not having anything in common. So here you can see, if let us suppose we have a set A which is having the elements 1, 3, 5, 7 and 9. We have a set B which is having the elements 2, 4, 6, 8 and 10. If you take intersection in both of their sets, so obviously you can clearly see there is no element which is present in both A and B. Both these sets are disjoint sets because their intersection is phi. Okay. Next is your principle of inclusion and exclusion. So principle of inclusion and exclusion states that sometimes when you try to add the elements which is present in both the sets, that is going to give us more number of elements here. What do I mean to say by this is, so let me explain you what is principle of inclusion and exclusion with more details. Assuming that we have a set A which is having the elements A, E, I, O, U, okay. We have a set B which is having the element A, B, C, D, E and F. Now if you want to find out how many number of elements are present in A union B, so number of elements present in A union B, how can you find it? This is equal to number of elements present in A plus number of elements present in B minus number of elements that is present in A intersection B. See, what happens is in this case, if you see both the set A and B, if you count the number of elements in A, so that is 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So number of elements in A is 5 plus. What is the number of elements in B? That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So that is 6. So if you add the number of elements in A as well as number of elements in B, that is going to be 11. Now, if you find out the union, in that case, we will not be having 11 elements because there are two elements which is present in both A and B. Again, I am saying, if you will try to find out the union, in union, two elements are common because two elements are present in both set A as well as those elements are also present in set B. So, elements are A and E. both of these elements are present in set A as well as set B. So the union will be having elements 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9. So union is only having 9 elements. So how can you find out this value? Is add the number of elements in set A plus the number of elements in set B minus the number of elements which is present in A intersection B. So A intersection B will be having only 2 elements. Therefore, here you can see this value will be 11 minus 2, which is equal to 9. The reason is why we subtracted this value is because there are elements which are counted in A as well as elements, those elements are also counted in B. But in union, we count those elements as 1, we do not count separately. I mean, we do not add 2 A in union, we only add once. Okay. So that is very simple principle, which is principle of inclusion and exclusion. I don't think so there will be any doubts. It's a very simple principle. But again, we will be discussing this principle in more details in the upcoming lectures, in upcoming topics. The higher format of this principle of inclusion and exclusion we are going to discuss. The higher format will be containing how can you apply this principle of inclusion and exclusion when you have 3 sets, when you have 4 sets, 5 sets. So we can do that by proof by induction. That is something that we are going to study in the upcoming lectures. So right now, knowing that there exists a principle of inclusion and exclusion, this much is fine. You don't have to study in depth because we are going to take this topic in depth in the upcoming lectures itself. Okay. If I'm going too fast, just let me know. The reason why I'm speaking fast and teaching fast right now is because I feel that you already know these topics. And at any point of time, if you feel that I'm going too fast, just let me know. Because these topics are very easy. They are just kindergarten stuff. So I feel that you already know these topics. That is why I am teaching fast. But if you feel I'm fast, just let me know. Okay. Next is your set difference operator as well as set complementation. So what is a set difference operator? So set, in case of set difference, let me explain you with the help of proper example. Let us assume that we have a set A which is having the values 1, 3, 5, 7, 9 and 11. We have a set B which is having the values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. These are 2 sets. Now if I do A minus B, so this is basically a set operation, difference operator, and I can also do B minus A. So this is a difference operator. So when you do A minus B, it means that we are going to remove all the elements which are present in B from A. And here in this case, we are going to remove all the elements which are present in A from B. Okay. So for example here, if you do A minus B, from A minus B, I'm going to remove 1. So because 1 is present in B as well as it is also present in A. I'm going to remove 3 because 3 is present in B as well as it is also present in A. We are going to remove 5 because 5 is present in B as well as it is also present in A. But we cannot remove 7, 9 and 11 because they are not present in B. So here A minus B will be 7, 9 and 11. But if you are doing B minus A, so B minus A means we are going to remove those elements which are present in A from B. For example, 1 is present in A, it is also present in B. Second, 2 is present in B but not in A, so we can have 2 here. Now 3 is present in A, so we are going to remove from B. Now 4 is not present in A, so 4 will be here. 5 is present in A, so we cannot write it, as well as 6 is only present in B. So here A minus B is 7 minus 7, 9, 11 and B minus A is 2, 4 and 6. So you can clearly see that A minus B is not equal to B minus A. So you can clearly say that the set difference operation is not commutative. Set difference operation is not commutative. So you can clearly see from this, set difference operation is not commutative. Okay. So next operator is your set complementation operation. So it is just like a normal complementation operation. So just for example, let us assume that we have a universal set which is containing all English alphabet which is A to Z, okay, and we have a set B which is having alphabets A, E, I, O, U. So basically if you do B complement, so B complement will be universal set minus B. So that means all the elements which are present in the B, they will be removed from the universal set. That will be your B complement. So I feel that you already know that complementation and set difference operation. That is why I am not covering in more details here. But if you feel that you have any doubts, please, you are free to ask. Please ask your doubts. So I want to give you enough time to ask your doubts. But any case, if you feel that there is any issues, please stop me then and there and ask me your doubts. So again, this is just a diagrammatic representation of both set difference operation as well as complementation operation. So first is representing set difference. So here we are doing A minus B. A minus B means all the elements which are present in B, they will be removed from A. So this is the only part that is left in A. Now when you do complementation, so if you do A complement, that means all the elements that are present in universal set, they will come, and all the elements that are present in A, they will not come. So this is representing A complementation. Okay. So this is just a basic definition of complementation. I feel I have already explained the complementation, so I don't have to explain the basic definition. But you can study the basic definition from the PDF that I have already provided you. Okay. See, complementation is very simple. Complementation is universal set minus A. Complementation is universal set minus A. So all the elements that are present in universal set, all the elements that are present in A, they will be subtracted from the universal set. For example, if I say the universal set is set of integer numbers, and we have a set of odd numbers. For example, if I say the universal set is set of integer numbers, and we have a set A which is set of odd integers. So if you do A complement will be set of even integers. So basically A complement will be universal set minus A. That is your A complementation. So roughly you can say that A complement is containing all the elements X such that this element X belongs to U, such that X does not belong to the set A. That means those elements belong to the universal set, but they should not belong to the set A. That is your complementation operation. Okay. Any doubts in complementation operation now? Please ask if you have any doubts in complementation operation. Or do you want me to explain this again, or is it fine? Fine, there are no doubts. Good, clean. So now these are some of the identities for sets. So basically you should remember a name of these identities. Actually by the end of this entire course, we will be using these identities so many times that naturally you are going to remember the names. But initially I'm just recommending you that because we are going to use these names so frequently, that it is better to remember the names. So for example, here the first identity is your identity law. So identity law says if you have a set A, and if you do an intersection with a union in the universal set, so then you are going to get the set A itself. And if you have a set A and if you do union with phi, so it is going to give you the set A itself. So phi represents an empty set. So second law here is domination law. Domination law says that if you do A union with universal set, so you are going to get the universal set only. If you do A intersection with phi, you are going to get phi only, where phi represents an empty set. Third law is your adimputation law. Adimputation law says if you have A union A, you are going to get A itself. If you do A intersection A, you are going to get A itself. That means if you do a union of a set with itself, you are going to get the same set. If you do intersection of a set with itself, you are going to get the same set. Next law is your complementation law. That means if you do complement two times, that is going to give you the same set. Complementing two times is going to give you the same set. Okay. So again, next law is your commutative law. Commutative law, generally it's always, I mean every time you are going to discuss the commutative law. So let me give you a simple idea behind it. So those who have studied discrete mathematics before, just study the topic of structure of algebra. So in case of structures of algebra, group, field, lattice. So later on we are also going to study group and fields. In that case, we will be studying about what is idempotency. So, and as well as what is identity law, because these laws should exist for any algebra. Now commutative law says that if you are going to apply the same operation and you can reverse their position, for example A union B is equal to B union A, I mean if you can change their position, so that is called as commutative law. So even if you do A multiplied by B, A multiplied by B is equal to B multiplied by A, so you can say with respect to the multiplication operation, if A and B are integer numbers, if A and B are integer numbers and multiplication is an operator, so you can say multiplication operator is commutative. But if A and B are integer numbers, then division operation is not commutative. So for example, A divided by B is not equal to B divided by A. For example, let us suppose A is number 2, B is number 5. So 2 multiplied by 5 is equal to 5 multiplied by 2, but 2 divided by 5 is not equal to 5 divided by 2. In the same way, if you do addition operation, now addition operation is commutative. For example, if you do A plus B, that is equal to B plus A, because 2 plus 5 is equal to 5 plus 2. But subtraction operation is not commutative, because if you do A minus B, that is not equal to B minus A, because 2 minus 5 is minus 3 and 5 minus 2 is 3. So minus 3 is not equal to 3. So you can see subtraction operation is not commutative, addition operation is commutative, division operation is not commutative, multiplication operation is commutative. So here you can see union as well as intersection, both of these operations are commutative. Next one is your associative law. So basically when you represent associative means if you have two unions together, now if you are going to evaluate the left union first, then the right, or if you evaluate the right union first and then the left, then in both the cases you are going to get same value. Okay, so here also you can see if you have intersection, if you are going to evaluate the right intersection first and then the left one, or if you evaluate the left intersection first and then the right one, again in both the cases you are going to get the same values. But in some operations this is not valid. Okay, so this associative laws are not valid in some of the operations. Let me show you with the help of example. If you know the power operator, for example if you do 2 power 3 power 2, 2 power 3 power 2, now if you are going to say, if you are going to evaluate first 2 power 3 and then power 2, that is not equal to 2 power 3 power 2, these are not equal, because in this case 2 raised to power 3 is 8 and then we have 8 square, and here in this case 2 raised to power 3 raised to power 2 is basically I think this is 6, I guess 8 square is also so let me give you another example then. I have to give you some other example. I mean there are some operations where associative law does not hold. Dave, you have to remember the names of these identities. These identities names are very important, because in examination they are going to ask with the names. Okay, so you can see, I mean later on we'll see associative laws also. I don't know if this XOR operation is associative or not, we have to see. So we are going to give, I'll give you some examples, some good examples where this associative operations does not hold. So right now just understand that, what do you mean by associative operations, that's it. Okay, Next is your distributive law. So distributive law says if you have A union B intersection C, that is equal to A union B intersection A union C. If you have A intersection B union C, that is equal to A intersection B union A intersection C. That is your distributive law. Okay, so distributive law actually in some cases distributive law does not hold. For example, if you take integer numbers, if you do 2 multiplied by 6 divided by 3 or 6 divided by 2, so or make it 2 plus 6 multiplied by 2. Now in this case, if you do 2 plus 6 multiplied by 2 plus 2, so maybe that does not hold. Here you can see 2 plus of 6 multiplied by 2, this value is going to be 2 plus 12, which is equal to 14. But if you try to distribute over this, so distribute is you can do 2 plus 6 multiplied by 2 plus 2, so that is going to be 8 multiplied by 4, which is equal to 32. So you can clearly see here distributive law does not hold. So you should know what are the operations where distributive law holds. So in this case, distributive law does not hold. But if you have union as well as intersection, in that case distributive law holds, because if you have A union B intersection C, that is going to be A union B intersection A union C. Even if you try to apply this distributive law with subtraction, I think in subtraction also distributive law does not hold. For example, if you have operators multiplication and subtraction, so if you have A 3 plus 2 minus 4, if you have this kind of example, so generally its value is 3 minus 2, which is equal to 1. But if we apply distributive law on this, so it will be 3 plus 2 minus 3 plus 4, which is equal to 3 plus 2 is 5 minus 3 plus 4 is 7, which is equal to minus 2. So you can clearly see even with addition and subtraction, distributive law does not hold. So we have to see, if you are going to study new operators, you have to see what are the operations you can do on that operator. So here in this operator, distributive in union and intersection, distributive law holds. In union and intersection, associative law holds. In union and intersection, commutative law also holds. So these laws are going to be very useful while you are going to solve questions. Next one is your De Morgan's law. So again, you can see De Morgan's law also hold in union and intersection. Next is absorption law. Absorption law also holds. So which is A union A intersection B, there is going to be A. So how can you prove this absorption law? So let us assume we have a set A which is having the values 1, 2, 3 and 4. We have a set B which is having the values 4 and 5. Now if you try to find what is A intersection B, so A intersection B here in this case is going to have the value which is 4. Now if you try to do this, which is A union of A intersection B. Now here A set is having the values which is 1, 2, 3 and 4 union. A intersection B is having the values which is only 4. If you take union of this, you are going to get 1, 2, 3 and 4. So basically, if you do A union of A intersection B, you are going to get A itself. Or A intersection of A union B, you are going to get A itself. In both the cases, absorption law holds. Now there is one more way of explaining the absorption law, is that if this is representing the Venn diagram, this is a universal set, this is the set A and this is the set B. So here you can see what is A intersection B. So A intersection B is only this part. And if you do A union of A intersection B, so this entire is A and this entire is intersection. So if you do A union of A intersection B, you are going to get this complete part. That is why A union of A intersection B is going to give you only A. So that is your absorption law. So again, absorption law holds, and now complementation law also holds, which is A union of A complement is going to be universal set and A intersection of A complement is going to be 5. So you should know all these laws, because without the help of these laws you will not be able to solve questions. Any doubts in any of these laws? Kya aapko koi doubt hai mitro, my dear friends, do you have any other doubts? Jaldi se sabhi message kar dijiye, please everyone, please reply on the chat window if you have any doubts, so that we can move forward. If you still have any doubts, please ask. Smita, Sakshi, Ashi, Anupma. Okay. See, here you can see that if this entire is your universal set and this is the set A. So when I am talking about A, that means we have this part. This entire part is A. Okay. And when I am talking about A complement, so A complement is this part. So obviously if you take the union of both of them, you are going to get this complete universal set only. So you can say A union of A complement is going to be universal set only. Okay. And if you took A intersection of A complement, generally actually A intersection of A complement are disjoint sets, because they do not have anything in common. Element, any element that is present in A, that element will not be present in A complement. Any element that is present in A complement, that will not be present in A. Okay. So if you do A union of A complement, you are going to get the universal set. If you do A intersection of A complement, you are going to get phi. Is it clear? Good. So this is an example that you can see. This is just representing how can you prove De Morgan's law with the help of the logical notations or set builder notations. So you can read it later on after the class. Just go through it and you will understand it easily. Okay. So but it's important that you should go through this one, because if you skip these parts, the homework that I give you, if you skip any of these homeworks, then you will not be able to clear the examination easily. So these parts you should do. Okay. And this is again just a proof of this De Morgan's law. So this is how you can apply the De Morgan's law on this. Just take this as an exercise and do this by yourself, because this part is also going to be very useful. Okay, so whatever I give you for exercise, please do everything and do not skip anything. Okay, so this is just for sets, and now we have to start our important topic, which is relations. तो सेट्स के अंदर हम लोगों ने बेसिक्स ऑफ सेट्स को कवर किया था. नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू कवर रिलेशंस. सो दिस रिलेशन टॉपिक इज गोइंग टू बी वेरी गुड एंड यूजफुल. इट इज गोइंग टू बी वेरी यूजफुल इन अदर सब्जेक्ट्स आल्सो. कूल माय स्मार्ट पीपल. Dev, to know which operations you have to apply, the only solution is to practice. If you will not practice the questions, then you will not be able to know which concepts you have to apply. So just go through the Kenneth H. Rawson book. Let me show you the book first. You can go to Google and search Kenneth H. Rawson. So on Google, you can just do a simple search. Kenneth H. Rawson PDF. Just search this and you will find the books. There are many places where you can see the books are already available. Okay. So instead of asking me for the PDF of the book, it's better that if you first of all you do a simple Google search. By a simple Google search, on the very first page of Google, you'll find this book. Okay. So this is taking some time to load because the book is pretty heavy. I guess this is loaded. So this is the 6th edition of the book, and in this book you can go to this chapter which is sets. So go to the second chapter, sets. So the second chapter, sets, here it will be in the page 111. So let me put the page 130. So you can see that this is your chapter sets. This is your second chapter, which is sets, functions, sequences and sums. If you go in this book, Kenneth H. Rawson, so you will find all the theory, all the text theory here. Just consult the standard books only for practice purposes. So I've created these PPTs from this book only. So these are the exercise questions. As you can see, in the book itself you will find a lot of exercise questions. Just solve these questions, right? So you can see I've taken this example in the classroom. We have solved this example, right? So these examples you can solve, okay? So these examples are already available. You can just use this example, okay? So you can use this example to practice. This is the only thing that I can advise. Fine. Good. So what exactly is relation? Generally, relation is how two things are related to each other. That is how we describe what is a relation. Now let me give you a very simple example. If you have studied the subject database management system, in database management system you have an entity and there are various attributes of the entity. For example, the entity is a student. Now the attributes of student can be roll number, first name, last name, subject, class, branch, and so on. Now all these things are related with the students. How? For example, we can say the roll number 5 belongs to the student named Himanshu. I can say roll number 6 belongs to the student named Diksha. I can say roll number 7 belongs to the student named Harika. I can say roll number 8 belongs to the student named Dev. So we have an association between these two, that this particular roll number belongs to this particular student. And how these roll numbers belong to that particular student, that depends according to their association only, how these two things are related with each other. So if you see the table that we create in discrete mathematics, that table actually represents your relations. Actually we call that table as a relation, and how these two entities are interrelated with each other, we call it as a relationship. So the formal term for a table in database management system is a relation, and when we say it as a table, that is an informal term. So relation means how things are related with each other, that is called as relations. Now here in this case we are going to discuss about relations. So relations, we are going to tell how the entities are related with, how things are related with each other. This is how we are going to explain relations. Let me explain you with a very simple example. For example, we can have set of numbers, set of positive integer numbers, right? So let us assume this is a set A, or you can say the set A is having the values which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and so on. We can say we have a set B which is the name of the student. The name of the student is Himanshu. The name of the student is Shalini. The name of the student is Harika. The name of the student is maybe Agastya. So these may be different names of the students. Now if I do A cross B, so A cross B is going to give us every combination of these two sets. Let us assume the first set is only having values till maybe 6, 5 and 6. So A cross B is going to give us a value which is 1 comma Himanshu. We can have 1 comma Shalini. We can have 1 comma Harika. We can have 1 comma Agastya. In the same way, we can have 2 comma Himanshu.
2, Shalini, 2, Harika, 2, Agastya.
Right, so this way we can have various combinations. Now, if let us assume that roll number 1 belongs to Himanshu, so this will be in our relation. So we can say how A is related to B, we can say in A related to B, this roll number should belong to that particular guy. So in A related to B, I'll be having 1, Himanshu, because we said the roll number 1 is related to Himanshu. Maybe let us assume that roll number 2 is related to Harika. So we can have 2, Harika. Let us assume we have roll number 3 which is related to Agastya. So we can have 3, Agastya. And roll number 4 is related to Shalini. So we can have 4, Shalini. Right? So this is how we can say how these two sets, how the values of these two sets are related with each other. So we shows a relation with them. So this is representing some kind of relation. Now in the same way, we can have a relation from one set to another set, or we can have a relation on the same set. We can have a relation over A cross A. So A cross A is a set, and we can define a relation over the same set. Okay. So when we say what exactly is the relation, relation means how the sets, how the values are interrelated with each other. This is how we are going to define what exactly is a relation. Now, let us just first of all read the definition, then I'll give you more examples of a relation. I'll explain you the relation in more details, or you can say in a proper manner. So first of all, let us read this example. So we can say let A and B be a set. A binary relation from A to B is a subset of A cross B, right? So in this sentence, you have to notice that any binary relation or a binary relation from A to B is a subset of A cross B. So any relation that we are going to have between A and B, so that will always be a subset of the cross product of A and B. Okay. By the way, this line doesn't say anything much. It just says that relation is a subset of that. Okay. And in other words, a binary relation from A to B is a set R of ordered pair. This is important. Is a set R of ordered pair. Why ordered pair? Because A cross B, this cross product is going to return an ordered pair, because order of the elements will matter. Because here you can see that A cross B will not be equal to B cross A. Here, A cross B is not equal to B cross A. So because the order which is 1, Himanshu is not equal to Himanshu, 1. This order matters. So whenever you are going to have a binary relation, so that binary relation will be a subset of A cross B, and the elements of A cross B will be an ordered pair, where the first element of each ordered pair comes from A and second element of each ordered pair comes from B, and we use the notation ARB to denote the element A, B belong to the relation. What do you mean by this is, let us assume this is a set A, this is a set B. If you do A cross B, so you are going to get this set. Now, here you can see in A cross B, the first element is from the set A and the second element is from set B. First element is from set A, the second element is from set B. The first element here is from set A, the second element is from set B. And secondly, this element 1, Himanshu is present here in the relation. So we can say 1 is related to Himanshu. Okay, so if let us suppose 1, Himanshu belong to the relation, that means we can say 1 is related to Himanshu. This is what we want to say. Okay, now if some element is not present here, for example, you can see 1, Shalini is not present in ARB. So we can say if 1, Shalini is not present in the relation, that means 1 is not related to Shalini. Okay. So if some elements are present here from this A cross B, that means we say these elements are related with each other. So this is how we represent the relations and their properties. Now, do you have any doubts in this? Ask me doubt, because I don't think so you understood anything properly. First shoot me your questions, let me answer your questions related to relations, and then I'll move forward. First ask me, sir, what is relation? Shoot me your question which you feel that you did not understand. आपको जो चीज़ समझ में नहीं आया, प्लीज़ मुझसे पूछ लीजिए पहले, कि बस आपको ये समझ में आना चाहिए रिलेशंस है क्या, उसके बाद मैं आपको बताऊंगा कि रिलेशंस की प्रॉपर्टीज़ क्या है. तो पहले बस आस्क मी योर क्वेश्चन, शूट मी योर क्वेश्चंस, देन आई विल आंसर योर, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट मी आंसर योर क्वेश्चंस, देन अकॉर्डिंगली आई विल मूव फॉरवर्ड. read this definition first. Note it down in your notebook. पहले इस definition को read करो, अपनी notebook में note करो. Then I will move forward because writing is also very important. Okay, तो I think सबको clear हो गया है. But still let me repeat it again. देखो basically relation says how the elements are related to each other. किस तरीके से दो चीज़ें एक दूसरे से related है, that is what relation is. Now here if अगर मैं बोलता हूँ कि हमारे पास एक सेट है A जिसके अंदर नंबर्स है 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. हमारे पास एक सेट है B जिसके अंदर नाम है हिमांशु, शालिनी, हरिका एंड अगस्त्या. अब अगर मैं A क्रॉस B को लेता हूँ तो A क्रॉस B का मतलब है कि हमारे पास यहाँ पर हर एक चीज़ का कॉम्बिनेशन आ जाएगा, जैसे कि 1 हिमांशु, 1 शालिनी, 1 हरिका, 1 अगस्त्या. 2 हिमांशु, 2 शालिनी, 2 हरिका, 2 अगस्त्या. 3 हिमांशु, 3 शालिनी, 3 हरिका, 3 अगस्त्या. 4 हिमांशु, 4 शालिनी, 4 हरिका, 4 अगस्त्या. तो जितने भी यहाँ पर एलिमेंट्स हैं सभी एलिमेंट्स का कॉम्बिनेशन जो है वो A क्रॉस B में आएगा. लेकिन इन सभी का कॉम्बिनेशन होना इसका मतलब ये नहीं है कि हर एक एलिमेंट एक दूसरे से रिलेटेड हो. जैसे कि लेट अस अज्यूम कि रोल नंबर 1 हिमांशु को अलोकेटेड है, तो रोल नंबर 1 शालिनी को अलोकेट नहीं हो सकता, रोल नंबर 1 हरिका को अलोकेट नहीं हो सकता, रोल नंबर 1 अगस्त्या को अलोकेट नहीं हो सकता. तो जो हमारा रोल नंबर 1 है वो हिमांशु को अलोकेटेड है, रोल नंबर 2 हरिका को अलोकेटेड है, रोल नंबर 3 जो है वो अगस्त्या को अलोकेटेड है और रोल नंबर 4 शालिनी को अलोकेटेड है. इसका मतलब क्या है कि 1 जो है वो हिमांशु से रिलेटेड है, 2 जो है वो हरिका से रिलेटेड है, 3 जो है वो अगस्त्या से रिलेटेड है और 4 जो है वो शालिनी के साथ रिलेटेड है. तो अगर कुछ एलिमेंट एक दूसरे से रिलेटेड है तो हम उसको बोलते हैं ए आर बी, यानी कि 1 इज रिलेटेड टू हिमांशु. अगर कोई एलिमेंट रिलेटेड नहीं है तो वी कैन से ए, और यहाँ पर आर को क्रॉस किया गया है यानी कि आर को कट किया गया है. ये पीपीटी आपके पास में ऑलरेडी सेंड है, अगर यहाँ पर विजिबल ना हो तो अपने पास जो पीपीटी है उसमें प्लीज़ चेक कीजिएगा. तो यहाँ पर आर को कट किया गया, आर को क्रॉस कर किया गया है, तो वो यहाँ पर इसमें ऑलरेडी है. ठीक है, तो ये आप देख सकते हैं. फाइन, आई होप आपको समझ में आया होगा. लेट मी मूव फॉरवर्ड. सो नेक्स्ट इज हाउ यू रिप्रेजेंट रिलेशंस. रिलेशंस को किस तरीके से हम रिप्रेजेंट करते हैं, दिस इज व्हाट वी आर शोइंग इन दिस केस. सो देयर आर वेरियस वेज ऑफ रिप्रेजेंटेशन. द फर्स्ट वे इज योर सेट रिप्रेजेंटेशन. तो जिस तरीके से हमने सेट में रिप्रेजेंट किया था, सो दैट इज योर फर्स्ट वे ऑफ रिप्रेजेंटिंग द रिलेशंस इन अ सेट, हाउ दिस एलिमेंट्स आर रिलेटेड. देयर आर अदर टू वेज. This is the another way where if 0 is related to A, so we'll have an arrow. If 0 is related to B, then we'll have an arrow. If 2 is related to B, then we will have an arrow. If 1 is related to A, then we'll have an arrow. Or we can also represent it in a tabular format. So wherever we have the relations. So see, let me show you what I mean to say here is. Here we have a set A which is having the values which is 0, 1 and 2. And we have a set B which is having the values which are A, B. Now if you take A cross B, now in case of A cross B, we are going to get 0, A, we are going to get 0, B, we will be having 1, A, we will be having 1, B, we will be having 2, A, we will be having 2, B. So these are the elements that is present in A cross B. Now, having all these elements in cross product does not mean that all these elements are related. So let us assume here this 0 is related to A. Let us assume 0 is also related to B. So 1 is related to A, but 1 is not related to B. So in our relation, 1 is not related to B. And 2 is not related to A, but 2 is related to B. So assume this is your relation. This is your relation R1. And this relation R1 is defined on the set which is A cross B. Now, ab is relation ko represent karne ke liye hamare paas teen tarike hain. This is the very first method where this is your set representation, where you are going to write all these elements in the set, or you can say you are going to mention all these elements in a set. The second representation is this diagrammatic representation, where if 0 is related to A, you are going to have 0 to A, there is an arrow. Why there is an arrow? Because here order matters. Cross product gives you an ordered pair. So ordered pair means the order of the element matters. So 0, A is not equal to A, 0. So here we have 0, A. That means 0 is related to A. So we are going to have an arrow. 1, A means 1 is related to A. So we are going to have an arrow. 0, B. That means 0 is related to B. So we are going to have an arrow. 2 comma b, that means 2 is equal to b, therefore 4, we are going to have an arrow. And second way, this third way is your tabular representation, where you are going to represent them in the form of a table. So in case of your tabular representation, you are just going to put cross signs wherever these elements are related. For example, 0 is related to a, so we are going to have a cross. 0 is related to b, so we are going to have a cross. 1 is related to a, so we are going to have a cross. 2 is related to b, so we are going to have a cross. So cross is just representing a marking that these elements are interrelated with each other. So this is your representation of relations. Okay, I hope there is no doubts in this. Yes, Sakshi, we can have relations according to some conditions. I'm going to take some examples here to show the relations according to the conditions. Okay, I'll take some examples. So this is representing relations on a set. So relations on a set means that the relation is based on one set only. I mean to say, when you do A cross B means you have taken two sets. Or for example, you have taken roll number cross product with names. That means these are two sets. But we can also have relations which are based on one set. We can have only one set, which is A, and we can have a cross product with A itself. Okay. So for example, we can say, let us assume that we have a set A which is having elements 1, 2, 3. If you do A cross A, so A cross A is going to give us 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3. We can have 3, 1, 3, 2, and 3, 3. So basically, this is A cross A. So if you define a relation over the same set, over this set itself, you are going to define a relation that is going to be said as a relation on a set. So you can say a relation on a set A is a relation from A to A. Whenever I'm going to say relation on a set A, so if this sentence is used, it means that relation is from A to A, or you can say relation from A cross product with A. Okay. So any relation here will be a subset of A cross A. So this is just an example here. Let A be the set which is 1, 2, 3, 4. So agar aapke paas A set hai 1, 2, 3, 4, then A cross A will be having total of 16 elements. Okay. So you can see, if let us suppose set A is having the elements which is 1, 2, 3, 4. Now if you try to find A cross A, so the cardinality of A cross A is going to be 16. Because A is having 4 elements, so A cross A will be having 4 into 4, which is equal to 16 elements. And now they are saying that our relation should follow this condition. Our relation should follow this condition, which is A comma B, such that A divides B. Okay, so jaise ki, if you take this example, first of all, let us explain this relation on this example, because it will be easier to explain. This is a short example, it will be easier to explain on this. So whenever we have element like 1 comma 1 here, in our relation the element will come if this B divides this A divides B. Sorry, if this A divides this B. For example, this 1 divides 1, so here in this relation 1 comma 1 can be there. Second, 1 divides 2, so here in the relation 1 comma 2 will be there. Third, 1 divides 3, so therefore in this relation 1 comma 3 will be there. Next, 2 does not divide 1, but 2 divides 2, so 2 divides 2 is there. Next, 2 does not divide 3, 3 does not divide 1, 3 does not divide 2, but 3 divides 3. So you can see this is a relation over this set A. I mean to say, when you are going to define some relation, you are going to define some of the conditions that the elements in the relation, they will be following certain kind of conditions. मैं फिर से इसको रिपीट करता हूँ. जब आप कुछ रिलेशंस को डिफाइन करेंगे, तो उस रिलेशंस में, रिलेशन में जो भी एलिमेंट्स होंगे, वो सभी एलिमेंट्स कुछ कंडीशन को फॉलो करेंगे. जैसे कि हमारे पास सेट ए है, इसका क्रॉस प्रोडक्ट आपके पास ये रहेगा. अब मैंने बोला कि जो भी हमारा रिलेशन है, उस रिलेशन में वो सभी एलिमेंट्स आएंगे जो कि इस कंडीशन को फॉलो कर रहे हैं. कंडीशन क्या होगी कि ये जो पहला ए है वो बी को डिवाइड करे. इफ दिस ए डिवाइड्स बी, देन दिस एलिमेंट्स विल बी प्रेजेंट इन दिस रिलेशन. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, 1 डिवाइड्स 1, 1 डिवाइड्स 2, 1 डिवाइड्स 3, 2 डिवाइड्स 2, 3 डिवाइड्स 3, एंड ऑल दिस एलिमेंट शुड प्रेजेंट इन द सेट ए क्रॉस ए. सो दिस इज वट द रिलेशन इज, दीज आर द एलिमेंट्स इन दिस रिलेशन. In the same way, if we have the set A which is having 4 elements, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, so in that case, so the elements which are following this condition, they will be 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, because 1 divides 1, 1 divides 2, 1 divides 3, 1 divides 4, here 2, 2 because 2 divides 2, and 2, 4 because 2 divides 4, 3, 3 because 3 divides 3, and 4, 4 because 4 divides 4. So here these elements will be present in this relation. Okay, is it clear? Any doubts in this? Good. If it is clear, then please answer the following questions. So let us look at this example first. Let us assume that we have a set A which is having the elements 1, 2, 3. So we can see cardinality of A cross A will be 9, because there will be 9 elements in A cross A. Now they are saying that we have these relations. The first relation is all the elements will come, element A comma B will come if A is less than or equal to B. In second case, A should be greater than B. In third case, A is equal to B or A is equal to minus B. In the fourth case, we have A is equal to B. In the fifth case, we have A is equal to plus B. In the sixth, A is equal to B plus 1. In the sixth case, we have A plus B is less than equal to 3. Okay, so so try to answer these questions. Here in relation R1, what are the elements? Please write in this so in the relation R1, please write the elements which is present in the relation R1. Okay, in the relation R2, please write the elements which are present in the relation R2 in the chart window. Please write what are the elements in present in the relation R1, what are the elements present in the relation R2, what are the elements present in the relation R3. Please write in the chat window what are the elements present in the relation R1, R2 and R3. So let me see, let us assume that for R1 we have a set A which is having 1, 2, 3. For R2 we have a set A which is having elements 1, 2, 3. For R3 we have a set A which is having the elements -2, -1, 0, 1, 2. Okay, and for R4 we have the set A which is having the elements 1, 2, 3. For R5 we have the set A which is having the elements 1, 0, 1, 2, 3. And here for R6 we have a set A which is having the elements 1, 2, 3, 4. So write down what are the elements, what are the values will be in these relations. Okay, jaldi se everyone, for each of these relations R1 to R6, please write down what are the values that will be present in them. Good. So let me explain you the solutions here. If the set A is containing 1, 2 and 3, so A cross A will be having 1, 1, 1, 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 1, 3, 2, and 3, 3. So these are the elements will be present, that will be present in A cross A. Now here you can see that we have R1 which is A comma B such that A is less than or equal to B. So that means here all the elements will be present where the first element is less than the second element. So you can see here that 1 is less than 2, 1 is less than 3, 2 is less than 3, 2 is equal to 2, 1 is equal to 1, 3 is equal to 3. So here you can see it is not just asking less than, they are also asking A should be less than or equal to B. So if 1 is equal to 1, 1 is less than 2, 1 is less than 3, 2 is equal to 2, 2 is less than 3, and 3 is equal to 3. So the elements that will be present in the first relation R1, they will be, R1 will be containing 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 2, 3, and 3, 3. So these elements will be present in the relation R1. Okay, Now the next case they are asking the in the elements here A should be greater than B. So if A is greater than B, change the pen. So the next case A is greater than B. So here in this case you can see 2 is greater than 1, 3 is greater than 1 and 3 is greater than 2. So here in this case in the relation R2 the elements will be 2, 1, 3, 2 and we are going to have 3, 1. So there will be 3 elements in the relation R2 which is 2, 1, 3, 2 and 3, 1. Okay, now in the relation R3 you can see either A should be equal to B or A should be equal to minus B. Now here A is containing 4 elements, so A cross A will be containing total of 16 elements. So here the numbers where A is equal to B, they will be -1, -1 will be there, next 0, 0 will be there, 1, 1 will be there, 2, 2 will be there, as well as A should be equal to minus B. That means we can have 1, -1. So these elements will be present in the relation R3. Now if you look at the relation R4, in that case here A and B should be equal, so the elements will be 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3. In the relation R5, A should be equal to B plus 1. So in that case if here the numbers are 0, 1, 2 and 3, so that means these are total of 4 elements. So A cross A will be containing total of 16 elements. So in those 16 elements, we have to check if A is equal to B plus 1. So that will be the case if we have 0, 1 because 0 is equal to, sorry, here we'll be having 1, 0 because A is equal to B plus 1. We can also have 2, 1 because A is equal to B plus 1. We can have 3, 2 because A is equal to B plus 1. I guess there will be only 3 elements. I don't think so, there is more than 3 elements. Okay, so we can have 1, 0, we can have 2, 1, we can have 3, 2 in this case. Okay, so this is R5. So 1, 1 will not be there in R5. Okay, so next R6 is A plus B should be less than equal to 3. So we have 1, 1 because 1 plus 1 is 2, which is less than equal to 3. We can have 1, 2 because 1 plus 2 is 3, which is again less than equal to 3. We cannot have 1, 3, we cannot have 1, 4, we cannot have 2, 3, we cannot have yes, we can have 2, 1 can be there. 1, 3 and 3, 1 will not be there. 1, 4 and 4, 1 will not be there. So in this case you can see we'll be having 3 elements, which is 1, 1, 1, 2 and 2, 1. So please check if your answers are correct. If your answers are not correct, please write in the chat window if you need any explanation for them. Please check if you need any explanation for any of these options. Please let me know if you need any explanation for any one of them. I need answers from all of you. If all of your answers are correct, please write in the chat window that yes, they are correct. Otherwise, if you need an explanation, please let me know. If your explanations are correct, then only I will move forward. Tell me, Sakshi, the last line, we have to check all the pairs in one relation, or yes, we have to check all the pairs in one relation. So now answer this question, which of these relations contain this pair? In R3, yes, one and minus one, as well as minus one and one will be there. R3 mein there is one more value that should be added. If one and minus one is there, so -1, 1 should also be there. This is my mistake. So in R3, we also have -1, 1. Because they are asking A should be equal to minus B. So if one and minus one is there, so -1, 1 should also be there. Okay. Good. Now all of you, please answer me this question. If let us assume we have a set A which is having a total of n elements, it is cardinality of A is n. Okay, therefore cardinality of A cross A will be n square. Now tell me, how many relations are possible? How many relations are possible on a set A with n elements? So when I'm asking about how many relations, that means how many unique relations are possible on a set A with n elements. Please answer me this question and write your answer in the chat window. How many relations are possible on a set A with n elements? How many relations are possible on a set A with n elements? Please answer me this question. Minus 1 comma 1 is there because see here you can see in R3 we have A should be equal to minus B. So if A is 1, so B should be minus 1. Or A is minus 1, then B should be 1. So the answer here is, what is the answer? Please tell me the answer, my dear friends. How many relations are possible on a set A with n elements? So the answer is, should I reveal the answer? The answer is 2 raised to power n square. There are 2 raised to power n square relations are possible. 2 raised to power n square relations are possible. Okay, let me explain you with the help of example. Let us assume that we have a set A which is having elements 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 up to so on till n. This is the set A which is having total of n elements. Now my first question here is, how many subsets of A possible? So how many subsets of A are possible? Number of subsets is 2 raised to power n. Why? Because here in every subset we have a choice whether this element 1 should be there in the subset or not. So it is having 2 choices. Whether this element 2 will be there in the subset or not. So this element is having 2 choices. Whether this element 3 is in the subset or not. Whether this element 4 should be there in the subset or not. Whether this element 5 should be there in the subset or not. So in the same way, for all these n elements, we have 2 choices. So how many choices we have? There is 2 into 2 into 2 into 2 up to so on till 2. So this is basically 2 raised to power n. So you can see for a set, there are 2 raised to power n. Subsets are possible. That is why the cardinality of a power set of a set is 2 raised to power n. Okay. Now if you see, we have A cross A. So the cardinality of A cross A is n square. Okay, if set A, if the cardinality of set A is n, so the cardinality of the set A cross A will be n square. Now, with these n square, we will be having these n square elements. So the elements will be 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, up to so on, 1, n. And then 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, up to so on, 2, n. In the same way, we'll be having till n, 1, n, 2, n, 3, up to so on, n, n. So if you count all these elements, so these elements will be total of n square elements. So if you want to have a relation, in any relation, each of these elements are having 2 choices. For example, 1, 1 is having 2 choices. 1, 2 is having 2 choices. 1, 3 is having 2 choices. So this is having 2 choices, this is having 2 choices, this is having 2 choices. In the same way, this is also having 2 choices. So we have total of n square elements and every element is having 2 choices. If you do a cross, if you do multiplication, you will find out there are 2 raised to power n square choices. Or you can say there are 2 raised to power n square different relations are possible over this set. So 2 raised to power n square, 2 raised to power n square relations are possible over the set which is A cross A. Is it clear? Kya ye sabko clear hai? Is it clear? I hope this portion is clear, my dear friends. मेरे प्यारे मित्रों, टू रेस पावर एन स्क्वायर, इज देयर एनीवन जिसको समझ में नहीं आया, जल्दी से लिख दीजिए चैट विंडो के अंदर अगर आपको समझ में नहीं आया, माय डियर फ्रेंड्स। अगर आपको समझ में नहीं आया देन आई कैन एक्सप्लेन इट अगेन और आई कैन मूव फॉरवर्ड. जल्दी से लिख दीजिए, आई गॉट ओनली वन रिप्लाई कि क्लियर है, बाकी सभी फटाफट लिख दीजिए अगर क्लियर है तो, नहीं है तो आई कैन मूव फॉरवर्ड. आई गॉट ओनली 5-6 रिप्लाईज, जल्दी से बाकी सभी स्टूडेंट्स रिप्लाई कर दीजिए. आई गॉट रिप्लाई फ्रॉम विजय, साक्षी, ज्योति, लक्ष्मी, हरिका, आशी एंड पल्लवी. देर आर 16 पीपल वॉचिंग एंड आई गॉट ओनली अगेस 8 रिप्लाईज. बाकी सभी स्टूडेंट जल्दी से रिप्लाई कर दीजिए फटाफट. आई शुड नो कि आप देख रहे हैं, जिंदा हैं, हंसते खेलते मुस्कराते पढ़ रहे हैं. गुड, चलो. सो नाउ देर आर वेरियस प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ अ रिलेशन विच डिफाइंस व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट काइंड्स ऑफ रिलेशंस वी हैव. सो फर्स्ट टाइप ऑफ रिलेशन इज योर रिफ्लेक्सिव रिलेशन, सेकेंड टाइप ऑफ रिलेशन इज योर इररिफ्लेक्सिव रिलेशन, थर्ड टाइप ऑफ रिलेशन इज योर सिमेट्रिक रिलेशन, फोर्थ टाइप ऑफ रिलेशन इज योर एंटी सिमेट्रिक, फिफ्थ टाइप इज असिमेट्रिक, सिक्स्थ इज ट्रांजिटिव, सेवन्थ इज इक्विवेलेंस. अ पार्ट ऑफ दिस वी ऑल्सो हैव पोसेट्स विच इज पार्शली ऑर्डर्ड सेट्स. सो आफ्टर इक्विवेलेंस वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट पोसेट दैट इज पार्शली ऑर्डर्ड सेट. सो टुडे आई वॉन्ट टू कवर ऑल ऑफ देम, इफ इट इज पॉसिबल वी वॉन्ट टू कवर ऑल दिस टाइप ऑफ रिलेशंस दैट इज रिफ्लेक्सिव, इरिफ्लेक्सिव, सिमेट्रिक, एंटी सिमेट्रिक, असिमेट्रिक, ट्रांजिटिव एंड इक्विवेलेंस. आई वॉन्ट टू कवर ऑल ऑफ दिस इन टुडेज क्लास. इफ इन एनी केस वी आर नॉट एबल टू कवर ऑल ऑफ देम इन टुडेज क्लास देन वी विल cover them in tomorrow's class. So tomorrow we'll finish them as well as we are also going to start possets and lattices. So tomorrow I want to finish posset as well as lattice with it. Okay. So we can have a break after half an hour, I guess. Let's have the class right now. So we can have a break around after half an hour. We started at 6:30, so I think I should give the break at 8:30, okay? Try if you see if you can control for half an hour, okay? So this is just an example of a relation. So as you can see in databases, we have the table and the formal term of a table is a relation. Formal term of a table is a relation. So as you can see here in this table, we have student, we have ID number, we have major, and we have GPAs. And how these entities are related with each other, this is defining a relation, okay? Now let us look at the very first type of relation, which is reflexive relation. When do you call a relation as a reflexive? Just read the definition. See Jyoti, we will have a break at, I guess, 8:30 or 8:40. For half an hour. After that again we will do the class till 10. I want to extend the class till 10 or maybe 10:30. Okay. So this is the definition of a reflexive relation. A relation R on a set A is called reflexive if every element A is also related to the element A, for every element A belong to the set A. Okay. Sure, after the class, this link will be active. You can watch this video with the link. And by tomorrow evening, the editing of this video will also be uploaded in the Google Drive. So this the link that I sent you for the class, this link will be available and active till tomorrow. Okay. So tomorrow, the edited video will also be uploaded. Okay. So let us assume we have a set A, which is 1, 2, and 3. And we have A cross A, which is having 1,1, 1,2, 1,3, 2,1, 2,2, 2,3, 3,1, 3,2, and 3,3. Now, a relation is said to be reflexive if it contains the diagonal elements. Diagonal elements means all the diagonal elements should be there. That means in a relation, we should have 1,1, we should have 2,2, we should have 3,3. So, a relation is said to be reflexive if all these diagonal elements are present. And a part of these diagonal elements, other elements have a choice. For example, this element can be there in the relation or not. This element can be there in the relation. This element can be there in the relation. This element can be there in the relation or it may not be there. This may be there, may not be there. This may be there, may not be there. So, diagonal elements do not have a choice. A relation is said to be a reflexive relation if all these diagonal elements are present. If these diagonal elements are not present, then we say the relation is not reflexive. Is it clear? What do you mean by reflexive? So again, I'm repeating, all the diagonal elements should be present in the relation for the relation to be reflexive. If these diagonal elements are not present in the relation, then the relation is not reflexive. Okay, is it clear? So all these diagonal elements, they should be there. Other elements have a choice whether they won't be there or they want do not want to be there. That's their choice. Okay, so now out of all these six relations, which is relation R1, R2, R3, R4, R5 and R6, we have a set A which is having the elements 1, 2, 3 and 4. Set is having the elements 1, 2, 3 and 4. And here we have relation R1, R2, R3, R4, I5 and R6. Tell me, out of all these relations, which of these relations is reflexive and which of these relations is not reflexive? Tell me which of these relations are reflexive. Tell me which of these relations are reflexive. R1, R2, R3, R4, R5 and R6. Which of these relations are reflexive? So here you can see we have the element which is 1, 2, 3, 4. So we have a set A. We have a set A and set A is having the element 1, 2, 3, 4. Therefore, A cross A should be having the elements which is 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 2, 1, 2, 2, 3, 2, 4, 3, 1, 3, 2, 3, 3, and 3, 4, 4, 1, 4, 2, 4, 3, and 4, 4. This is A cross A. For any relation to be reflexive, it is mandatory that all the diagonal elements should be present. That means 1, 1 should be present, 2, 2 should be present, 3, 3 should be present and 4, 4 should be present. They should be present and all the other elements have a choice whether they should be there, they are there or they are not there. For example, the relation R1, 1, 1 is there, 2, 2 is there, 4, 4 is there, but 3, 3 is not there. This is the reason, because yahan par 3, 3 nahi hai, because 3, 3 is not there, so we can say R1 is not reflexive, correct? So second is R2. In case of R2, only 1, 1 is there, 2, 2, 3, 3 and 4, 4 is not there. That is why R2 is not reflexive. Look at R3. In case of R3, 1, 1 is there, 2, 2 is there, 3, 3 is there and 4, 4 is there. All the diagonal elements are present. That is why this relation R3 is reflexive. In case of relation R4, 1, 1 is not there, 2, 2 is not there, 3, 3 is not there and 4, 4 is not there. So R4 is not reflexive. Look at the relation R5. We have 1, 1, we have 2, 2, we have 3, 3, we have 4, 4. So all these elements are present. That is why we can say R5 is reflexive. R6 is not reflexive because it is not containing the diagonal elements. So only reflexive relations here are R3 and R5. I hope all of you got the answer correctly. Agar kisi ko doubt hai to please ask. I think this question was very easy about reflexive relations. Agar kisi ko koi bhi doubt hai, any of my friend, my dear friends, mitro, koi doubt hai to batao. Mere pyare se hai paathiyo. So this is the question, that let us assume we have a set A and this cardinality of set A is n. Therefore the cardinality of set A cross A will be n square. Now my question is, what are the number of reflexive relations possible on a set A? If we have a set A which is having cardinality as n, then what are the number of reflexive relations are possible on the set A? A set, set A ke upar kitne reflexive relations possible hai? So jiska answer nahi aata, you can just write sir do not know without any hesitation, because I am going to explain later on. And those who can find out the answer, maybe you can guess the answer, just write the answer in the chat window. And those who cannot find, please say don't know something. But at least you should reply so that I'll understand that you are listening to me. 16 people are watching. I got replies only from 6 people. Sabhi jaldi jaldi reply kar dijiye please. Everyone please reply. Okay, so let me explain you So the total number of relations possible are 2 raised to power n square minus n. So this is 2 raised to power n square minus n. Let me explain you how. Okay. So basically, if let us assume that cardinality of set A is n, so your A cross A, the cardinality will be n square. So in your A cross A, you will be having the elements like 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, up to so on, 1, n. Then we'll be having 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, up to so on, 2, n. Then again 3, 1, 3, 2, 3, 3, up to so on, 3, n. Again 4, 1, 4, 2, 4, 3, up to 4, 4, up to so on, 4, n. Up to so on till n, 1, n, 2, up to so on till n, n. Now, if the relation has to be reflexive, in that case, all these diagonal elements should be there. They do not have a choice. In a reflexive relation, all the diagonal elements should be there. They do not have a choice. They should be present at any condition. So how many diagonal elements are there? So these are total of n diagonal elements, which is 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, up to n, n. So there are total n diagonal elements. There are total n diagonal elements. Now, how many elements are there which are not diagonal? So for example, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 2, 3, 2, 4, 2, 5, 3, 1, 3, 2, 4, 1, 4, 2. These are not diagonal elements. So how many diagonal elements? So you can say the non-diagonal elements will be, they will be n square minus n, where n is the total number of elements. So these are total number of elements are n square, and n is the diagonal element. So non-diagonal elements will be n square minus n. So in a reflexive relation, for a reflexive relation, all diagonal elements should be there. All the diagonal elements should be there. That means they do not have a choice. So all these diagonal elements do not have a choice. They only have one choice. But the non-diagonal elements have a choice. They might be there and they might not be there. For 1, 2 might be there, it might not be there. 1, 3 might be there, might not be there. 1, 4 might be there, might not be there. So all the non-diagonal elements have a choice, but diagonal elements do not have a choice. So all the non-diagonal elements have two choices. They might be there, might not be there. Might be there, might not be there. Might be there, might not be there, and so on. So all these non-diagonal elements have two choices. So how many non-diagonal elements are there? So that is n square minus n. Every element have two choices. So if you multiply all these twos, so you will find out how many multiplications are there. So this is 2 raised to power n square minus n. So this is the number of choices for non-diagonal element. And for the diagonal element, they have only one choice. So this is 1 multiplied by 2 raised to power n square minus n, which is equal to total 2 raised to power n square minus n. So if anyone asks you, a set A is having total of n element, then how many elements will be there? So how many unique reflexive relations are possible? So there are total 2 raised to power n square minus n reflexive relations are possible in this case. How many reflexive relations are possible? Total 2 raised to power n square minus n. So please write in the chat window if you did not understand. जल्दी से मुझे बता दीजिए अगर आपको समझ में नहीं आया. अगर आपको समझ में आया है तो मुझे so that I can move forward. अगर आपको समझ में नहीं आया तो जल्दी से मुझे बता दीजिए. अगर समझ में आ गया that's fine. Write quickly please. I need fast answer. You guys are smart, super smart, super 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 super. Garima, good to see you. It's your first reply in the chat window. Ashi, it's a very reply after very long time. Ashi, you are not replying. Sure, Harika, please write your explanation. No issues, take your time. I think if you understood, that's also fine. So as you can see, these are examples of reflexive relations. For example, the first example is equal to. So generally, if you have a relation like you have a relation on a set A, such that relation is x, such that relation is we have element a comma b, such that a is equal to b, and a comma b belong to the set A. So this is an example of is equal to relation, and this relation is reflexive. Second is a subset of. So subset of relation is also reflexive. So if you have sets, so we say that A is a subset of B, right? So if you take a set and the power sets, so in case of you can see ki kaun sa kiska subset hai. Accordingly, again you can see that is also reflexive. Divides relation is also reflexive, because 1 divides 1, 2 divides 2, 3 divides 3, 4 divides 4. That is also reflexive. Greater than or equal to is also reflexive. Here it is reflexive because yahan par equal to sign hai. Agar yahan par sirf greater than hota, to ye reflexive nahi hota. Jaise ki we can say we have R1 is equal to A comma B, such that A is greater than or equal to B, and A comma B belong to the set A. So this relation is reflexive. Agar yahan par equal to nahi hota, if equality was not there, only A is greater than B is there. So in that case, this is not reflexive. So this is only reflexive because A comma greater than or equal to is there. Next is less than or equal to. So less than or equal to means this less than or equal to. It is reflexive because equal to sign is there. If equal to sign is not there, then it is not reflexive. The relation is parallel to is reflexive on a set of all lines. So if if line L1 is also parallel to line L2, and line L2 is also parallel to line L3, and line L1 is also parallel to itself, okay? So is parallel to is also reflexive. Fine. Now answer me these questions. I need answers. I need answers, my dear friends. Say true and false. Say true and false. So tell me A, B, C, D, E to H. Which of these statements is true? Which of these statements is false? Say true and false in the chat window. Which of these statements is true? Which of these statements is false? Sabhi se replies chahiye. Need replies from everyone. True and false. So the answer here is the first A. This is true. Subset is false. This is true. And this is also true. And this is false. So true, false, true, true, false. Okay. So this is true. So set of all reflexive relations are closed in the operation intersection. This is also true. Closed in the operation difference. This is false. So how many of you got the correct answer? So A, C, D, F and G, they are true. B, E and H are false. So most of you got the answer wrong. Most of you got the answer wrong. Let me explain you all these answers first of all. So let us assume that we have a set A which is having elements 1, 2, 3. We have a relation R1, and R1 is reflexive, therefore it is having 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3. It is also having 1, 2 and 3, 1. So R1 is reflexive. We have a relation R2 which is also reflexive, so it is also having 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3 and 2, 1 and 3, 2. So this relation R2 is also reflexive. So you can see R1 is reflexive and R2 is reflexive. So R1 is reflexive. If you take every superset of R1, that means all the present, all the items that are present in R1, they should be present in the superset. Plus supersets can also contain extra elements. So you can see, even if you take a superset of R1, that superset will also be reflexive. So you can say this is true. Second is, if R1 is reflexive, then every subset of R1 is reflexive. That is false, because the subset of R1 may not contain this element. The subset may not contain this element. So subset might not be having some elements. So you can see the subset of R1 might not be reflexive. okay? It might be reflexive, but might not be reflexive. So by guarantee, we can say that some of the subset might be reflexive, some of the subsets might not be reflexive. So I'm ruling out that every subset will not be reflexive. Some subsets can be reflexive, but every subset of R1 will not be reflexive. Next, R1 and R2 are reflexive, then R1 intersection R2 is reflexive. Even if you take R1 intersection R2 here, so all these diagonal elements will definitely come in the intersection. Now check out, if R1 and R2 are reflexive, then R1 union R2 is reflexive. Clearly, if you take the union of R1 and R2, you will find out it is reflexive, because all these diagonal elements will definitely come. If R1 and R2 are reflexive, then R1 minus R2 is reflexive. That is also wrong, because R1 minus R2 will subtract all these diagonal elements, so the relation will not be reflexive. Next, the set of all reflexive relations are closed under the operation union. So first of all, you should understand what is this closed, okay? Let us assume that this is the set of integers, okay? What do you mean by operation closed? So let us take operation which is addition. So closed means if you take two elements from the same set and if you perform this operation on these two elements, then you are going to get a third element which is present in the same set. For example, if you do 2 plus 3, you are going to get 5. So 2 is an integer, 3 is an integer, 5 is also an integer. That means if you take two elements from the same set and if you perform some operation, then you are going to get the result from the same set, then we say that it is closed under that particular operation. But if you perform the operation multiplication, again, integers are closed under multiplication. If you multiply two integers, we are going to get integer only. That is why integers are closed under multiplication. But integers are not closed under division, because if you divide an integer by another integer, you might not get integer. For example, if you do 3 divided by 2, you are going to get 1.5. So 3 is an integer, 2 is an integer, but 1.5 is not an integer. So you can say set of integers is not closed under division. So in the same way, when we say the set of all reflexive relations are closed under operation set union, that is true, because if you see, if you take any two relations which are reflexive, that means this is a set of reflexive relations. If you take any two relations which are reflexive and if you take union of them, definitely you are going to get a relation which is also reflexive. So reflexive relations are closed under set union. Next, reflexive relations are closed under the set intersection. That is also true. If you have two relations which are reflexive, if you take intersection of those two relations, you will get a relation which is reflexive, because in both of these reflexive relations, these diagonal elements are already present. So if you take intersection of two reflexive relations, you will get a reflexive relation. That is why it is true. But if you take the difference operation, so if you subtract R1 minus R2, these diagonal elements will be subtracted. Hence, you can clearly see the result will not be a reflexive relation. So reflexive relations are not closed under the operation difference. I hope this part is clear. Reflexive relations are not closed under difference. Okay. So I hope this part is clear. So you can see A is true, B is false, C is true, D is true, E is true, so E is false, F is true, G is true, and H is false. Is there anyone here who could not understand each of these part? क्या यहाँ पर किसी को ये क्वेश्चन समझ में नहीं आया है? जल्दी से लिख दीजिए अगर किसी को डाउट है तो, otherwise I will give a break. फटाफट सभी लिख दीजिए, if it is clear, clear, clear लिख दीजिए, if it is not clear, just update. See here, Dev, R1 and R2, both of them are reflexive. Why? If we have a set A which is having elements 1, 2 and 3, so A cross A will be having total 9 elements. So if R1 has to be reflexive, then diagonal elements will be there. Non-diagonal elements might be there, might not be there. It doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is diagonal elements should be there. So R1 is reflexive because all the diagonal elements are there. R2 is reflexive because all the diagonal elements are there. Non-diagonal elements might be there, might not be there. That's not an issue. Okay. So R1 and R2 both are reflexive. Okay. Any doubts, Dev? I hope this is clear with everyone. Jaldi se bata dijiye if it is clear. I got replies from most of the students. Fine. So I got replies from everyone, I guess. So it's 8:44, so I'm giving you a break because some of you might have to go for dinner. After the break, this is a half an hour break. After the break, I'll take your availability for the class. If more than 10 students are available for the class, definitely I will do the class. If less than 10 students are available, if all the students are not available, then maybe we'll have a class tomorrow. Okay, I can reduce this number to 7 to 8, but most of you should be available for the class. Okay, so this is a break for half an hour. Take the break, have dinner, then I'll message of the group, and if most of you are available, then definitely we'll have the class. What do you want me to explain, Dev? Please ask your question clearly. Yes, A cross A needs to contain 9 elements, but I have given you the relations. I have not written A cross A. So A cross A will be having 9 elements. So these are just relations over A. Just check out both of these relations. A is to A set. If R1 is reflexive, part A is saying R1 is reflexive. This is already a reflexive relation on a set A. So if you take the superset of this reflexive relation on a set A, so every superset of R1 will be reflexive because already all the diagonal elements are present in R1. So do one thing, take a set A and try to find all the superset of R1, and you will see that all the diagonal elements are already present. These elements are already present. Okay. All these diagonal elements are already present. That is why this is reflexive. See, this reflexive R1 relation is on the set A. Correct? So every superset of R1 we will take on the set A only. So if R1 is already having diagonal elements, so every superset of R1 will be having diagonal elements. So because every superset will also be having diagonal elements, that is why every superset of R1 will also be reflexive. Clear? Is it clear? Good. Chalo, have dinner, and after the dinner I'll message again on the chat window on the Telegram group. If at least 10 students are available, then definitely I'll have a class. Otherwise we'll have a class tomorrow. Okay, so bye and take care.